morning, Tangible Grace. We're so excited to continue in this series through the parables where we're unpacking the stories that Jesus told, stories with a point, stories that help point us to who Jesus is and what he's doing in our midst. Today, we're going to unpack a couple of parables, one from Jesus and one actually from the Old Testament, from David and Nathan. And I'm really excited to dive into that with you today. If you want to read alongside me, we're going to be in two passages today. First in Matthew chapter 20, and then later we'll be in 2 Samuel 12. So let's dive into Matthew 20. Jesus says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. And after agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day," that's a normal wage for a day's work, "he sent them out in the vineyard to work. And going out the third hour, he saw others idle in the marketplace, and he hired them. And then the sixth hour, and ninth hour, and then all the way to the 11th hour. And he said to him, why are you not working? Why do you stand idle here all day?" And they say, "Because nobody's hired us." And he sends them into the vineyard as well. And then eventually he pays them all, and he pays them all the exact same wage, starting with the people who actually worked the shortest amount of time and leading all the way up to the people who, the text says, worked through the heat of the day. And they say, "It's not fair." The ones that worked through the heat of the day, they're like, "We get the same amount of money as the people that only worked 1 hour." And Jesus says in this parable, he says, "Take what belongs to me and go. I chose to give to the last worker as a gift to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity?" And Jesus comments, "So the last will be first and the first last." This parable is meant to unpack that the kingdom of God is decidedly unfair, and that's actually really good news, that God in his kingdom does not base our status with him vertically based on anything we do horizontally, that anything, any good works, any good things we do, they do not change how much God loves us, that whether we've loved God for a very long time or maybe just a few moments, that God treats us the same if we have faith in our heart in Jesus as Lord, that if we believe in God, just like the thief on the cross, we can to enjoy paradise, the new kingdom, the new heaven and new earth with Jesus when he comes back to make all things new, whether we believe in Jesus for a long time or a short time. The point of this parable is that we're not meant to compare ourselves to one another. Lots of texts in the Bible talk about this idea of comparison. At the end of the Gospel of John, Peter looks over at actually John, the author of the Gospel of John, and says, "What about him?" There were rumors that the Apostle John was going to be the only person not martyred among the 12. And so Jesus says, "Don't worry about John, worry about yourself, and you indeed will die for the faith." That Jesus, according to Peter, according to church tradition, hung upside down on the cross because he considered himself unworthy to die in the exact same way as Jesus. And yet, John was exiled to Patmos, and I believe that was so that John had enough time in his life to write the book of Revelation, one of the last books of the Bible to be written. And so that desire for comparison, I think, is something that can slip into our hearts even now. Paul says in Corinthians that we should defer to our, quote, weaker brother, or a brother that has a heavy conscience. The idea here is that in Corinthians that there were these disciples that were really struggling with the idea in this house church in Corinth of, should we eat meat that has been sacrificed to idols or not? And Paul says, if it's meat literally inside of a temple, don't go to that temple and eat in that temple, because then you might be worshiping a false god. But if it's meat that's just in the marketplace that might have been spoken over and sacrificed to idols, then that's a matter of conscience. And if it causes your weaker brother to stumble, then just don't eat meat at all, he says. And so I think here, the comparison in our own lives is, some of us are going to have different levels of conscience. Are we going to wear a mask? Or are we going to wear gloves? Or are we going to, so how are social distancing going to look for each of our households, each of our families? When are we ready to go back to work, or go back to the grocery store, or go back to X, Y, or Z? When are we ready to do these kinds of things? Maybe you've just been getting deliveries and doing pickup like me and avoiding all stores in general. How long are we going to do that? I don't know the right answer to any of those questions. But my encouragement is this, that we don't judge one another, that we don't lord over our decisions as the exact right God-given answer and say that whatever someone else is doing is wrong. That we're patient with one another, we're generous with one another, we're gracious with one another, and that we allow people to have different responses to very difficult, complex situations. So with that in mind, I want us to dive into the idea of fairness into 2 Samuel 12. I love this passage because this is an example of a parable not just in the New Testament, but in the Old Testament. So a little bit of context, David had committed a horrible sin. He had committed adultery by sleeping with someone else's wife, and then he tries to cover it up, House of Cards style, and he tries to cover it up and kill and eliminate all evidence of his crime by committing more and more sins. And then after all this happens, the text says that it greatly displeased the Lord. It really grieved the heart of the Lord, what David had done, and tried to hide it, but the Lord knew what he was doing. And so God doesn't just directly attack Nathan. Instead, he tells him a parable. Just like Jesus tells parables to people who are on their guard, on their defensive, to crowds that don't know what to think of Jesus, in the same way, God sends Nathan to David. It says in verse 1 of chapter 12 of 2 Samuel, "The Lord sent Nathan to David, and he came to him and said, 'There were two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had many flocks and herds and lots of lambs and sheep, but the poor man had nothing but one ewe lamb, one baby lamb, which he had bought. And he brought it up, and it grew up with him, and it was like his child. He used to eat a morsel of his bread and drink from his cup and lie in his arms. He'd snuggle with this lamb, and it was like a daughter to him. And now there came a traveler to the rich man. He was unwilling to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the guest who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and this pet, this almost child of his, and he prepared it for the man who had come. And then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said to Nathan, 'As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die and shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity.'" And here's the great line in verse 7. "Nathan said to David, 'You are that man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I appointed you king over Israel. I delivered you out of the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives in your arms. And I gave you the whole house of Israel and of Judah. And if this were too little, I would have added to you so much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight?'" And it goes on to chronicle all the things he did wrong and how he hid it. And it says that the sword will never depart your house. And there was division in the kingdom of Israel and Judah from that moment on. And it says in verse 12, "For you did it secretly, but I will do this before all of Israel, before the sun, publicly." And David said to Nathan, he said, "I have sinned against the Lord." Psalm 51 that I'm going to have you guys read as a group, I'm going to encourage you guys to read that because this is the psalm that David wrote in response to this moment where he says, "I have sinned against the Lord. Against you only have I sinned." And then Nathan said to David, "The Lord has also put away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, and this child who's born to you will actually die." And I don't understand why David doesn't die on his child does. But God has a plan for David and he has a plan for us. I don't understand why some parts of the country and some parts of the world are being more affected by this virus than others. I don't understand why all of this is happening, why there's negative and terrible, awful things happening in the world. But what I do know is that God is in the business of redeeming brokenness. That God is in the business of things that man means for evil, God works for good. That's the whole Joseph story in the book of Genesis. That God redeems even broken, awful things. You see, in this story, we're meant to experience the reality like David does, that all of the parables of God are meant to point at us. They're meant to include us, that we are that man in the story. We're meant to include ourselves, to see ourselves like a mirror. We're supposed to see ourselves in those stories. and that we are that man, that we don't get to pretend that these stories have nothing to do with us, and that we deserve death, that we deserve punishment, that apart from Jesus miraculously working in our lives, we would be condemned, just like David says that this man deserves to be condemned. But this story doesn't end with law. This story doesn't end with punishment. But it says at the end of the story that there's hope of resurrection. David, even the Old Testament, had hope of resurrection. He says, I shall go to him, but he will not return to me, knowing that one day when God makes all things new in the resurrection, the new kingdom, the new heaven, new earth, where there's no more viruses, no more sickness, no more pain, that we will get to go to God and see Jesus face to face. And the scripture says, and the Lord loved him and sent him another child, Solomon, one of Jesus' direct ancestors, that even though God sees that David did great wickedness, he still redeems his family, still redeems and gives him a second chance. I think so many of us right now as households, we are experiencing this lockdown as an opportunity for our families. I think so many of us have had opportunities to go deeper in God's word and go deeper as a family, to actually go on walks together, to have family meals together. I actually heard from one of our leaders just last week that he said, I went and bought a couple of household devotionals for us to do as a family. We hadn't been doing that much in the past, but now we have time to do it, so we're doing it. And God is redeeming this time. He's redeeming even this difficult season that we're in. So I encourage you guys, to, as a household, if you're watching this later online, I encourage you to read Psalm 51 together and what stands out from David's confession and prayer here. And then what phrase, what idea really sticks out to you? And then how can you as a household commit to placing yourself in the world and the worldview of Scripture? How can you learn to pray and be as honest and transparent as David was in his prayers in this psalm? I encourage you guys to go deep in God's word together, that you are encouraged to know that God is with you, that God loves you, and that you are not alone. I hope you guys are having a great week and look forward to continuing to dive into the parables of Jesus and the parables of even throughout Scripture. Hope you guys are having a great week, and God bless. Amen. Once for all, our debt is paid.